from this university for inviting me. As was mentioned, this is my first trip to India. And I've always wanted to come to India, and I was asked today why it took so long, and I just said, well, I don't know, I was busy doing other things. But Mahatma Gandhi once said that you should live as if you will die tomorrow, and learn as if you will live forever. So I'm living now, and I'm also learning. I've learned from people here. I've learned more about what you do. I've always felt that as a teacher and a researcher, I was very blessed because I was paid to learn. And I can't think of a better job to have than one where you are in a position to learn and you are paid for it. And I always told my students that if I didn't learn from them, they weren't very good students. And the good students understood what I was talking about because they asked questions from a viewpoint that completely different from what I was thinking about sometimes. And they asked good questions and made us all think. And so I suggest to those of you who are students here and the faculty that you can learn from each other if you talk and you discuss and keep an open mind and enjoy what you're doing. I'm very fortunate that I've enjoyed the kind of work that I do. I work in medical schools, I worked in physiology departments, I worked in physical education departments, I've worked for the government on exercise and heart disease, and I'll do all of that. I learned from other fields, and that's why, to me, now that I'm involved with something called exercise as medicine, I think it also brings in the idea that exercise is so important for us.
You're going to be getting prescriptions people. So I'm going to give you an idea. What would you do as a person or as a pharmacist if you added up a prescription that was inexpensive, cost effective, had few negative side effects, could prevent or treat dozens of diseases, could improve quality of life? Would you take that medication? Well, that prescription is exercise. Now, it's easy for people to talk about, for eating, because you have to eat. But exercise is something that people feel that they have to make time for. But most of the problems today are in what we call lifestyle diseases. And that means inactivity, diet, and non-smoking and that sort of thing, moderation, and a lot of different things. But exercise is a key part of that. As a matter of fact, the director of the National Institute on Aging once said that if exercise could be packed into a pill, it would be the single most widely prescribed and beneficial medicine in the nation. Okay, that's a powerful statement. We know that if people are more active, they tend to have less disease. The interesting thing is that you don't have to do as much for health as you do to try to improve your fitness. So if you're doing it for fitness, you need to do more. But if you're doing it for health, you need to do something on a regular basis. That's the most important thing. Do something you enjoy and do it regularly. There's no other. It's not a magic program. If you like to walk, if you like to swim, if you like to do other things, do it. That's the most important aspect. So, as I said, the amount that you need to benefit your health is much less than what you need to improve your fitness. Now, most of you are not in the field, but if you think about it, can you name one cardiovascular disease where exercise or physical activity is not a major part of the treatment protocol? Think about it. We have people who have heart attacks, they have strokes, they have high blood pressure. Exercise is a very important aspect of that. As a matter of fact, exercise reduces the risk of heart disease by 40%. It reduces the risk of stroke by 27%. And reduces the incidence of high blood pressure by 50%. Those are your major problems with cardiovascular disease, and exercise is very important for that. Can you mention one metabolic disorder where physical activity, exercise is not a part of the treatment? This is unfortunately what's happening many times. You know, they watch television, they drink beer, they eat food, and they put on weight. Regular physical activity reduces the incidence of diabetes by about 50%. Can reduce mortality and the risk of recurrent breast cancer by 50%. Can lower the colon cancer by 60%. That's fairly strong medicine. Can you think of one neuromuscular or orthopedic limitation where exercise is not part of it? You think of people who have injuries, you have people who have other orthopedic problems, exercise is part of what they do treatment. Can you name one psychological limitation where exercise is not part of that treatment? You can lower the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease by 33%. Now remember, this is populations, it's not on any one individual, but if I have a population of 10,000 people who are active, that 10,000 will be have less Alzheimer's than the group that was in sedentary. Now, in the United States, one of the most widely prescribed drugs is Prozac. It's an anti-anxiety. Okay? There was an interesting study done where they treated one group with Prozac, another group with exercise. And exercise decreased depression as effectively as Prozac or behavioral therapy. So you don't necessarily need to take the medication. Now, I know the pharmacists are saying, yeah, but that's my job, I have to do that, right? But there's still plenty of things that you can do, but you don't need to always give them a pill to take care of something that they can do by being more active. Okay, now I've told you some evidence that we've got that says that exercise really is quite good, all right? Now, what you need to do, if you're studying in this area, you need to say, what is the evidence? How strong is that evidence? Because it's easy to say, well, it's 25% or 50%, but we need to know more about what's going on. Well, the first thing you have to know is that there is variability in response. And we know this, the studies I've been involved with genetics, we know that. If we, for example, if you take a group of people and you train them and everyone improves by 10%, it says the training was the factor that was the most important. But if you train them and some improved 5% and some improved 40%, then there's something else that's been there. And it turns out genetics is one of those factors. The same thing with medication. A person goes to the doctor and says, I have this problem. And the doctor says, here's 10 milligrams. You take it, and it takes care of the problem. Next patient comes in with the same background and says, what can you do? You have to give them 20 milligrams to get the same effect. The third one comes in. Neither one of that drug has no effect. They have to go to a different drug, medication, before it has an effect. That is also affected by genetics. There are people who respond to certain things and not always to the same thing. So we know that there are going to be differences in how people respond to the same thing. And so the difference is primarily genetics. Now here's a study, for example. There are two studies, and they're very interesting studies. These are studies done a number of years ago with identical twins. Now, an identical twin is the same person in duplicate as far as his genetic background is concerned. They have exactly the same genes. And so what they did is they took about 12 pairs of identical twins and put them in a cabin in the northern part of Quebec. And the nearest house was 80 kilometers away. So they were completely isolated. Then they had 2 weeks to say, how much food do I have to give them? in order to maintain their weight. They established that. And then for the next 100 days, they gave them 1,000 calories a day more, maintaining their activity level, but giving them 1,000 calories a day more for 100 days. And you see here that there are some, this is one twin and this is the other twin. And on the same diet, you see there are some people who lost a lot of weight and some who lost very little weight. And if one twin lost a certain amount, the other twin lost a similar amount. I gained a similar amount. So genetics plays a role in that. Then they did another study in which they took another group and they determined how much food they needed to have and how active they were for 2 weeks. And then they said, okay, we're going to maintain the food intake the same, but now we're going to exercise 90 minutes a day for 100 days. Again, you see that there are some twins who, how much did, this is how much they lost. These people didn't lose much at all. So there's one set of twins. One lost 1 kilogram, the other one lost 2 kilograms. Here's one that one lost about, let's see, that's 6-7 kilograms, and the other one lost 6 kilograms. So you see, genetics plays a role in that. So there is variability. So you have to know that you're looking at that. That's one aspect to remember when you're looking and say, how strong is that evidence? This is the same thing if you train people for strength. And you see one twin doesn't gain much strength, neither does the other twin. If one twin gains a lot of strength, so does the other twin. So genetics plays a role in how we respond to training, to medication, to diet, all of these things. The study I was involved with, we started out with 800 people, and we trained them, and these are people from families. And you see in the 4 centers that after training, this is the average, and it's pretty much the same in all 4 centers. But you'll see in every center, there were some people who did not improve their fitness at all. And there were some who improved their fitness a lot more. So on the same program of 20 weeks, 3 times a week, up to 1 hour a day, 3 times a week, some people trained and they didn't improve at all. Other people improved. So we went from 0 to 50% improvement. There's a lot of variation. And we found that there were about 21 different genes associated with how people responded. And so if you had less than 2 of those genes, or less than nine of those genes, this is how much you improved. If you had, as you had more and more genes, it doesn't make a difference which ones. The more genes you had, the more you improved. So there is a genetic effect to that. And even with obesity, for example, this is looking at the number of genes associated with your body weight. So the more genes you have, the heavier you are. Well, this is what happens overall. But you see that the people who are active with the same genetic background weighed less than the people who are inactive weighed more. So you may have a genetic predisposition to obesity, but if you're active, you can take care of some of that. Not all of it, but some of it. So we have variable responses. We have large and small numbers studied. As I told you, we started with 800 people, wound up with 740. That's a big sample, okay? Most of the studies that you will do and that students do, they will take 10 people and compare with another 10 people. But imagine, let's say you were going to do a study and say, do men train better than women? And it just happens that in the group that you study, in the men, you happen to get some high responders, and the women, you happen to get some low responders. You would say, men train better than women. You do the study again with the only 10 people in each group, and you may say, well, now I have more high responders than women and some low responders than the men. You say, oh no, women train better than men. And you do it again, there's no difference. Which do you believe? Well, if you put 10 and you add them all up, so you have 30 and 30, and overall you get no difference. Now you have a better idea what's really happening. So anytime you do a small study, remember that you may, without knowing it, have some people who are different before you even do the study. So genetics is an important part, but so you're better off if you do large studies. Now what we have to do, since there's no one here who can do a study with 750 people, right? So what do? We have something called meta-analysis, where you look at all of the studies that are done looking at a certain thing, and if consistently all the studies show that one group trains better than another group, then you're confident that this is what's going on. Then we have another thing, and it's called randomized controlled studies. That's the gold standard. If I pick people and I say, okay, people from this school, and I'm going to compare them with people from this school, there may be something about that school that's different from that school, and therefore that's what's affecting what I'm finding. But if you randomly, let's say I were to here and I would take every third person, and so you're in one group. Every second, the second of the three people are in another group, and the other one is in the third group. Now I've randomly assigned that, unless there's some reason that you're sitting a certain way. Now I've controlled or minimized the chance of getting a biased sample. And that's, so anytime you can do randomized controlled studies, that's better. So if you can do large samples and do randomized controlled studies, that's the best way to do it. Now, having told you that, and I'll explain why here. If you want to look at the evidence, we have, what has been done recently is a number of experts sit together and say, how strong is the evidence for anything you're looking at? And so you've got the lowest is one and the highest is four. So the four says the evidence is overwhelming, and it's mainly large studies with randomized controlled studies. And it keeps showing the same thing over and over again. Then you're pretty sure, and that's your highest level of evidence. Then you have level three, which says it's strong evidence from a combination of randomized controlled studies and others, but occasionally there's a study that says something different. Those are still very strong. This is overwhelming, this is strong. Then we have others that say it's suggestive, but we don't, you know, it's there. It's probably something we don't know. And then the fourth level, number one, we just don't know. We don't have enough information. Now on the basis of that, what a number of experts have done is look at all the evidence that says how good is exercise. They've done it with other things too. How good is this medication, or how good is this treatment? And if you look at the evidence for cardiovascular disease or health benefits of regular physical activity to prevent coronary heart disease, 4. To treat heart disease, 3. Regression of the disease, 2. And preventing stroke is 2. But look at this. Preventing and treating heart disease. It says the evidence is really very strong. It's overwhelming. So we know that that's pretty good evidence. Cancer. Preventing colon cancer, 4. Preventing prostate cancer, breast cancer, 3. Uterine cancer, 2. Other cancers, preventing it, 1. And treating it. It's really not necessarily an effective as effective for treating it. We just don't know. But there, as I told you before, if you can prevent colon cancer by being more active, that's very good evidence. Diabetes. Type 2 diabetes, preventing it, 4. Treating it, 3. Improving the quality of life of a person who has diabetes, 3. And treating insulin dependence, 1. But so diabetes, that's very strong evidence that exercise can be useful. Osteoporosis, that's as women especially get older, the bones become more fragile, they break more easily. Increasing the bone density with exercise, 4. Preventing osteoporosis, 3. And treating it, 2. Because once you've got osteoporosis, it's difficult to treat it because you've got to the point where the amount of calcium in the bone is so low that you really can't do it. It's too late. So it's best to try to treat it. But you can prevent it by doing exercise of the right type. The cholesterol and the lipoproteins, triglycerides, which is the fat in the blood, is 3. This is 3, it's called the good cholesterol. Those are pretty good, the rest of it is not as good. High blood pressure, preventing and treating high blood pressure, 4. Exercise is very good for that. Psychological well-being, mood elevation. Look at these are all 4s. We have evidence that psychologically, people are better off if they're active in terms of their mood, less stress, alleviate, prevent depression, reduce anxiety, and improve self-esteem. That's very important. I was one of the members of this particular expert panel when we wrote our stuff in improving physical fitness of older people, 4. Counter the loss in the fitness is 2. Counter the loss in muscle, 3. Counter the gain in fat, 3. Improve life expectancy, 4. Improve quality of life. The interesting thing with older people is that if you actually get them to be more active and start doing strength work, they spontaneously become more active because now they can get out of the chair and then they start doing more. So just getting older people to be active is very important. So, I'm not going to repeat all this, but basically, there's very strong evidence that exercise is of use in preventing and treating a number of the problems that we face today in the industrialized countries. So remember, there are variable responses, and you don't always know which risk factor you're going to respond. One thing we found when we trained these people is that we looked at a number of risk factors, and a person comes in and say, I want to get the exercise program, or I want to take this medication because I want to change my weight. They may not change their weight, but they can change something else. And we don't know what's going to change simply because we don't know which genes are involved and how that particular genetic background of that individual is. So when we looked at 10 risk factors, no one didn't improve in something, and no one improved in all 10. Most people improved in 3 or 4 of these risk factors, but it may or may not be the one they wanted to do, but that's what they have. So all you can say is, next time, pick your parents better. And you can get a different genetic background, maybe. Okay? I can talk about this because, again, I cannot tell you for one individual. All I can say is 10,000 people who live this way are going to live longer than 10,000 people who live that way. But within each of those groups, there's going to be someone who's going to live less long, have a shorter life expectancy, and someone over here is going to have a longer life expectancy. But as a group, this group will be worse off. And all you can do is say, as a prudent person, what should I do? I want to be in this group. And that group says, you have to be more active, you have to watch your diet, you have to do a lot of other things. And that's the most important thing. So, I want to exercise to improve my chances of being in this group, because it's very important that I do that. And what we find, what's interesting is that when you take people who are very sedentary, and you start to exercise, you get the most benefit when they go from doing nothing to doing something. The people out here who are already very active, if they have to do a lot more activity to get just a small improvement because they're already active. They already got the people who do nothing start to do something. Remember I told you don't have to do as much to improve your health as you do your fitness. So just getting people started and becoming active on a regular basis. Also, going from the least fit to the most fit, you see the same thing. When you're going from the least fit to the next group, that's where you get your big drop. And then you get less of a drop. It's still there, but it's not as dramatic as here. So the most important thing, if you're not active at all, become active. Become a little bit more fit, and you'll get the benefit. Yes?
Do
So you really go from sitting just to walking or something like that. And that's good enough for most people. All right, I wanted to spend just a few more minutes just to let you know, and it's probably different in India. As a matter of fact, I'm sure it's different in India than in Canada and the United States. But there have been studies showing that people who are less active and have lower fitness levels also have higher healthcare expenses. But what you really need is lifestyle modification, not just exercise, but activity, diet, smoking, stress. And you try to do all of those things, the more you can do, the better chance you have. And this, just look at this. This, all this says is, and something happened to my slide, these things are not in order now, but just healthcare costs, the people who participated over 3 years in a physical activity program, their health care, they reduced their health care of $291 a year, as opposed to $360 for people who didn't participate. Inpatient hospital, $20 less, $119. Heart disease, $58 less, and $846 less over here. So again, just being active, you're going to have less health care costs. 6 month lifestyle modification, people improve their health, their quality of life 10%, their depression, they had less 30%, less anxiety, less body fat, better blood pressure, not much change in blood pressure, total health risk 25%. And 57% of the people who are high risk converted to low risk. That company, that saves them a lot of money in terms of the economic cost. There's a company that makes Pepsi Cola, a 7-year program for every dollar and 46 cents they invested. For every dollar they invested, they got back a dollar 46. So they actually made money by investing and trying to prevent. Another one, in one of the counties in Utah, they had a 5-year program. They saved $36 million. The return for every dollar they invested, they got back almost $4 in savings. So exercise is medicine, and it's important that we know that. So the message is, you can pay for disease, or you can invest in health. It's really a choice of that. Which is better to do? If you spend the time and you enjoy what you're doing and find something you enjoy and do it regularly, there will be some benefit. Again, as a group, or a given individual, we're not always sure. But as a group, we know for sure. Now, I'll finish this by just, I was telling about exercises, medicine, and what this is a program that the American College of Sports Medicine put together with the American Medical Association, in which they started a global health program to try to get people to be more active and to try to get physicians to ask just a simple thing. Every time you go in to get your blood pressure, you go in to see the doctor, they'll take your weight, they'll take your blood pressure. We want them to do, they just say, how active are you? What are you doing? What do you need to do? You need to do more, therefore it's going to be easy. So we want to put physical activity as part of the healthcare. We also want to, for those who are in biotechnology, we want to have a way of recording so that every time you come in, it's recorded. And there have been studies done, a real big insurance company that also works with the companies they insure, and they treat their patients. And every time these patients came in, they were asked, are you active? Why not? Here's some information. Become more active. And they found in that one company was something like 20,000 people that they saved $25 million. So for them, it was worth it to just to spend that small amount of time. So they want to get this on the record, and right now the physicians don't do it. Physicians say, I don't have time. So they say, I don't know what to tell them. Because in our schools, and probably here too,
position and all the things they have to learn, they're only, I think, and maybe 10 years ago, there were only 5 or 10 universities that had even one course. In some cases, they had one lecture come in for 1 hour, and that was their exposure, their exercise. So what they're doing now, they're trying to raise awareness. And the phase one of this exercises medicine program was to raise awareness and start developing national and international centers. And what they did, you see, the program now, there are more than 40 countries and 7 regions. And anything in green, there's no program. But we're in 40 other countries. Now you notice in this particular region, India, all the Indian subcontinent, with the exception of Singapore and Malaysia and Indonesia down here, they're not involved. We would like them to get involved, but right now they're not involved. But it's going very well, and so we're doing that. Phase two is to make sure that exercise is written down as a vital sign, just like blood pressure or anything else. Teach the healthcare providers and the fitness professionals what to do. So we have workshops where the healthcare professionals come in and we talk to them about exercise as medicine, how to prescribe exercise, especially the fitness people. We do that and they get certified, and then what happens is the physician says, I don't know what to tell them, but if the fitness person from a health club has been there, has taken the course, has taken the exam, they get listed so the physician in one city can say, where can I send them? Well, there are 5 people in this city who are certified and know something about this. So that we want the physician to send to the healthcare person and the healthcare person to refer back. And now they start a conversation between the physician and the other people. So we're trying to do that. And then the second part, to say, now that we're doing that, is it really making a difference? And there's a few studies just starting now saying that if you ask people enough times, they'll become more active. Because they say, my physician thinks it's important, therefore I should start doing something. So that's basically what we're doing. As I said, this I'm not going to go through. I've already mentioned it one time or another. And we're doing it in the communities because eventually we have to get to the point. In the United States, we spend more money than any other country. We spend twice as much money per person than any other country in the world. And we rank number 11 in quality of healthcare, because it's just so expensive. And what we're trying to do is get people to be more active and do more prevention, and that's what this program is about. So what I have tried to tell you is that there are some real benefits to exercise. There's a little doubt that it's worthwhile. And what we're trying to do is get people in many countries all over the world to start looking at that and say, yes, it's important. If we can make people more active and healthier, it's better for everyone. Thank you very much for your attention.